Hello, everyone, and welcome to the speaker series, Healing Starts Within. I'm your host, Aylen, from Harmony and Healing. And today we have Jen Giordano. Hello, Jen.
Hello, ladies. And is it gentlemen? Ladies and gentlemen? Yes.
And Jen is actually speaking with us from Ecuador, which is amazing. I bet she's just, there we go, just vibing and everything. Thank you so much for having us. So Jen is actually Go for it. We're going to be working through.
Oh, we had a little interruption. So I will just explain that. You can explain it probably, that the internet in Ecuador is very unstable at this time in the evening. But we embrace imperfection on this interview, don't we? Aylen and I have spoken about this.
Absolutely. We were talking about how, you know, we're always on, we're trying to always have our image a certain way, and perfectionism is always what we're seeking. And we're just like, you know what? We're going to be real in this interview. Whatever happens, happens, right? So I'm ready to embody all our
emotions. Yeah.
So Jen is a soul embodiment coach, a Usui Tibetan Reiki master, and metaphysician. So Jen, before we get into what you do, I would still love to go back and hear your journey to the work that you do today.
Yes, I love sharing stories. I think stories connect us. Our stories are what connect us and help us to inspire each other. When I use the word connect, I don't mean connect like social media connect, like digest and consume. But I mean, actually have two people sharing in a figure eight of energy, right? Like one person tells their story and then the other person tells their story and then they become one. When we share our stories, there's the oneness that we experience through that. My story, thank you, Aylen, for asking, began as a Baptist minister's daughter when I was a little girl, a wee one. And I come from an Irish, English, Italian heritage. I moved out of Hemet when I was 18, which is a small town in California. And I decided I was going to live my dream dolphin behavior because I just found dolphins to be, like ascended masters, like little gurus of joy. And I just love dolphins. I've always loved them since I went to SeaWorld as a five-year-old. They were healers for me. So I went to Hawaii. I achieved a big dream by coming from a, single mother household, impoverished from 15 to 17 years old. Those 2 years of my life where some people have their parents, helping them get to college. Mm-hmm. I didn't have that experience. I had to do everything myself. My mother divorced when I was 15. Those 2 years were really transitional for her. So she didn't have the time and energy to give to me. So I found resources, and that was the beginning of my resourcefulness training. So I found counselors. I found partners through my teachers in high school. I found people who would assist me to get my dream accomplished, right? To get to Hawaii Pacific University. And so that was my first big aha moment where it was like, I have no limitations. There truly are no limitations. We've been told if you don't have money, you can't go to a private university. Well, I accomplished the goal of going to a private university with very little money. And so that started the trajectory of my journey of my life, basically achieving quite a few dreams that I had. When I created a thought in my mind of what I wanted, I would manifest it. Moving back, I didn't have as much grants, loans, and scholarships, so I moved back to California, and I went and got my associate's degree, so I didn't get to finish 4 years, but it instilled in me the belief that you really can do anything, Jen. Just because you come from a single mother house doesn't mean you can't accomplish your dreams and goals. So I think I was just born with that. And since then, I have accomplished that bachelor's degree. I got a health education degree. I have moved into performance art. That was something that I did through my 20s. I started my first job as a magician's assistant at 17 years old. Yeah. And then I was a stunt performer for Disney, California Adventure Park. So I was going to school, then took a break for 3 years, was Max Magazine, was in Muscle Fitness, was a performance artist, a fire dancer, a Cirque du Soleil, like a performer. And I just kept so many groups in my 20s. That brings me to my 30s. When I hit degree, had become, okay, the connection looked froze. Is the connection stable now?
Okay, now it was. You were definitely going in and out. We were getting into your circus work, I think, is where we left off.
Right, okay, good. So the circus work is the circus from the age of 20 to the age of 24. I joined like an acrobatic troupe, and I was still getting my associate's degree, working on the more traditional approaches to success as the world sees success. But my heart had a calling, and that was just to learn to overcome seeming obstacles, to do whatever I chose, whatever I want. And that may change moment to moment. So the way I like to look at it is like, you know, the feminine energy is very chaotic. It's always changing. Emotional changes, desire changes, it's inevitable. The only constant in life is change. And so I became very adept at adaptation. Through the circus arts, the biggest thing I learned in those 5 years was that I loved performing, but I did not want to be a slave to the Hollywood circuit, the Hollywood system. Uh-huh. I did not want to sell my body, to sacrifice my beauty. I had a taste of it. I was able to get to the level where Fox Sports, Best Damn Sports Show Period, gave me an award. Wow. Because the producers, get this, loved the shape of my butt. If I said, This is terrible. And this was when I realized at 24 years old, very young, I don't want to be seen for that. I don't want opportunities to be given to me and handed to me because of my body. Mm. So at 24, I knew, okay, go back to school. You're not going to make it in this Hollywood industry, because you will lose your soul, you will lose your identity, you will lose your innocence. And something protected me, and I would say it's our souls that protect us, because everyone else would tell you're crazy, like you're getting famous, everyone wants a piece of you, they want to hire you for 8 episodes, why would you walk away from that? Because my soul told me the future is not bright for someone who comes from a disadvantaged background entering into the Hollywood world.
I see.
So from there, transitioned into school again and finished a bachelor's degree at the behest of my mother and my grandmother pressuring me, get the bachelor's degree, then you can have that to fall back on if entertainment doesn't work. And I'm so grateful for that, because I did learn to be an entrepreneur. That is how I learned to be an entrepreneur. I finished my 4-year education. I went into sales, corporate sales. I got really good at selling gastroenterology products and women's health products. And I learned because I built a territory in Los Angeles, one of the most competitive markets. So that's where the entrepreneurial skills came in. And I ended the career in corporate sales because of a spiritual awakening. And this is what my current project right now, I'm here in Ecuador writing a book about spiritual awakening, about how you seek and you search and you think that this is going to make me feel fulfilled. And it's not until you get to the real core essence of who you are as a soul, that you transcend all of what the ego and the world and what we call the Maya wants you to be. And when you're beautiful, when you have fair skin, unfortunately, that is a privilege to have beauty and fair skin, even though I came from the same disadvantaged background that a brown-skinned person or a black-skinned person came from. My looks helped me to get opportunities, especially in California. So I transitioned out of corporate sales and went into literally the mystic's hero's journey. And that leads me to where I am today. The past 10, 11 years of my life have been nothing but mystical manifestations, miracles, chaos, a little bit of drama, traumas, lots of near-death experiences, lots of shamanic medicine. But this is kind of the short version of my very long story of like living many lives in one life.
Right. I was going to say, you've dabbled in so much. I mean, you've had to have taken on knowledge and wisdom from each of those to really hone in on what your soul has been calling you to do. That's amazing. I do. One of the things that I love, yes, would love for you to speak on is the power of the womb, that you teach women about womb and womb energy. Can you speak on that a bit?
Yes, absolutely. Yes. So womb songs came to me about a year and a half ago, and it was in a time of deep despair and grief. I was feeling very much like a failure. I had a yoga studio, Kundalini yoga studio, that failed. It didn't work. I put everything into it. I came back from India, 4 months in India, and I threw my heart and soul and money and time, 14-hour days. I had 7 yoga teachers, some sound healers. I had hired people that relied and depended on me to get this thing going, and I failed because we couldn't earn enough income to balance what was outgoing, and I did not get my bank loan. And their excuse was, oh, nail salons are lucrative, you know, they're easy, people make money, but yoga studios usually fail. And this was in Utah. And so I just ended up literally on the streets homeless. I lost my home and I lost my yoga studio. So I moved back with my mother. Thank God for mothers. Thank God for mothers. And I felt ashamed at 37 years old, 38 years old. But this was the year that I actually was first published as a teacher and healer with an audience of 40,000 plus people on the Shift Network. So this dark night of the soul thing was happening, but also this beautiful light came into my life where I was able to be published for the first time. Yeah. And the Shift Network is a wonderful organization that does a lot of education on spirituality and awakening and the process of conscious, developing conscious awareness and letting go of your shadow and woman's work. So the womb work came out of my study of a woman named Claire Zammit. She's the leader, one of the leaders in women's work. And I started to sing. I started to go, you know, Kundalini yoga is very masculine because it's very intense. I want to do something more feminine for a practice, something beautiful, not hard. You know, I had been hard on myself long enough. So I put my hands in certain mudras on my body, and I was in front of a fireplace, and it just came in and through to start singing Jehovah Elohim. Now I've transitioned it into chanting Yeshua Elohim, which is Aramaic, Hebrew, comes from the Hebrew lineage. But to chant that brings in a divine presence of masculine protection, and you're calling upon that force that is Yeshua, the name of Christ. You know, Yeshua is the energy of the man we know as Jesus Christ. And he comes in during the beginning of the womb song meditation and places a shield around That's the intention. Then we start chanting vowels, which is called sounding, and it's a sound healing technique. And it's song. It's literally healing the womb through song, through sound, through the movement of energy, through sound, because your womb or your sacral chakra is connected to your throat chakra. If your sacral chakra is tight, your voice, your throat chakra cannot express. It's very limited. It's almost like a constriction here if your womb is full of other people's energy, right? Or thoughts or trauma and all the things that we store. You know, we don't just house babies in our womb. We house our dreams. We house our pleasures. We house a lot of energy in the womb. It's a portal. And I would say it's the most powerful part of a woman's energy system. Because when that's blocked is when you see leaning towards being masculine, leaning towards being dramatic and emotionally unbalanced, helping everybody else but not yourself, making sure everybody else's needs are met but not your own. I mean, these are like the result, the symptoms of an absolute absence of connection with the womb. So once you do connect with your womb, and my method is through sound, through song, you have an eternal best friend. And it doesn't matter what other women are doing to you, or your mommy isn't treating you right, or your daughter is treating you with disrespect. It doesn't even matter, because you hold the presence of your queendom. You're sitting on your own throne. Yeah. The womb is our throne.
Beautiful.
And so clearing it and knowing the name of it is beautiful. I've done this work with a few, probably close to about 100, 150 women in the past year.
Yeah.
It's something I was experimenting with. And now it's something that I'm really presenting and bringing out, because we have to get connected to the embodying our own energy. Like, not taking everybody else's energy and transmuting it and changing that, you know, processing it like little trash cans. That was the image that came to me. It was like, you are a divine vessel for eternal cosmic power and love and sensuality and pleasure and creation. You are a trash can, right? And so the womb so often can be this center where we collect things from our partners and lovers and babies and children and whatnot. And we have all these cords in there. Well, we don't serve humanity, ourselves or others, by being stuffed full of energies. We serve others best when we know who we are. We stand strong in that grace and dignity, and life gets easy, and we look beautiful to the world. It doesn't matter what our physical presentation, we could be overweight, we could be, you know, we could have pimples all over our face. We could still exude radiance and beauty.
Our essence.
And I think that comes in the womb. Beautiful. What did you say?
No, I was saying more so our essence is what becomes seen and beautiful, right? Yeah.
Yes. 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 Yeah.
I also love the idea that you have of being your own guru. I have an appreciation for any type of healer, a person that is all about empowering the client, or, you know, the patient, whoever it may be. So what does that
mean? You want to make yourself obsolete. You want to help them to the point where they don't need you anymore.
Exactly. So what does it mean as far as becoming your own guru?
Pardon me for the little, I have to do the wipe because it's so greasy here.
No problem.
So empowering people to be their own guru means that they use you as a jumping board, but it's the most beautiful way of being used. It's not being used for your looks and your beauty. It's being used for God's will in each individual's life that comes across your path.
Beautiful.
Being a servant, or what we call a sevadar in the Kundalini Yoga and the Sikh tradition, being a servant of God is not offensive. It's not like, oh, I'm a goddess, I shouldn't be in service. No, yes, when you are a true goddess or queen, you are in service to the people that are under your care. And Find the Guru in You came from a deep desire for me to not have clients constantly come to me expecting too much, demanding. I was tired of them coming and not having results because they didn't do the work.
Right.
So I started to develop this idea that if I call it something different, if I set the expectation up front that you have to do your own work, that's going to make that's going to improve my program. And it did. I mean, people have catalyzing experiences in 40 days, wow. Right? Like Jesus, 40 days in the desert. That was where he conquered all his temptations. And then after that, his ministry began. So that's how I see this is Find the Guru in You, the program I do for 40 days. Once you're done with it, your life is not going to be perfect. It's not like a regular life coach that says, oh, you're going to create all these wonderful millions of dollars and your perfect mate. No, you are going to get hit with every temptation. The higher you climb up the ladder of consciousness, the harder it gets. But the benefit of it, you're ready for everything that comes at you.
There you go.
You know how to stay in your heart. You know the peace of the Jedi move, you know, how to move around energy and, shapeshift instead of resisting, fighting, warring, or going up against. And so in 40 days, I use the science and technology of Kundalini Yoga. I use the mantras that come from the Sikh, the beautiful Sikh language of Gurmukhi, which is a very ancient language that bases itself on sounds and codes written into the sounds to connect you to the Guru, which just means from darkness to light. Guru is one who takes you from darkness to light. So why can you not be your own guru? This is what we must do. The age, the dawning of the guru is kind of gone now that technology and internet, and we can teach ourselves stuff. We don't have to go to a mountain, to a cave, meet a guru, get an awakening with him, putting his fingers on your head, ascending to the stars. Like, it's faster now, and you can do it yourself. Because of the way the planet is shifting and the energy body of Gaia, the Earth's energy body, the spirit of the Earth, which is called Gaia, she is supporting us to enter this age of Aquarius, which is the age of enlightenment, the age of self-awareness, where we move away from knowledge and what you know and the Piscean masculine, I know, to I am, I experience. You become the experiencer, and then you develop wisdom. And wisdom to me is where abundance can come into your life. It doesn't mean abundance financially. It means abundance of everything your heart desires. And so finding the guru in you, what's the payoff? That's the payoff.
Sounds great. Sign me up, right? Wow. Yes. No. And 40 days. To get everything that your heart desires doesn't sound like a long time at all.
And it's not. And when you believe that you can have instantaneous miraculous healing and hearing.
Yeah, hearing.
Then it happens. when you can understand that it can be so fast. Yeah. And that's why I call myself a metaphysician, because you know how a surgeon goes in and cuts things out very precisely?
Sure.
That is what Find the Guru in You will do for you.
Gorgeous. Awesome. So, Jen, I'm asking all of my speakers this one question in particular, but what does healing from within mean to you?
Healing from within is getting time alone. Okay. And maybe that's why we're filming this when I am traveling alone. At least the first part of my adventure, I'm very rarely alone because I always have people around me. I'm an extrovert introvert, but I am in this, I'm in this beautiful place. In Ecuador, on the beach, in a surfer's paradise called Montecitas. And I'm alone, but I'm meeting people. So if I feel the need to dance with someone else's energy, I do. And then I lay a boundary. Okay, time to go. And I'm going to go be in my own space now. And you can do that when you travel alone. Now, I know a lot of women that are mothers and wives. They're like, I can't be alone. I just can't. That's a belief. Your husband will, if he's a good husband, he knows he will benefit from you being a happy wife. Happy wife, happy life.
Yes.
Allow you your own space, your own time to be within, to go within. Sure. With no responsibilities, no demands on your time, attention, or energy. And the experience of being able to like listen to your soul come through, you know, and bless you with knowledge and bless you with energy, because that's how we fill up. You know, we go into nature, we spend time alone.
Yeah.
And the women who don't ever spend time alone that I have met in my life, and I will admit this may be a judgment because I don't have kids and I don't have a husband. But if you don't have enough time to yourself, you usually go cuckoo.
Sure.
You see them on pain medications. You see them on antidepressants. You see them on Ativan. You see them on addicted to wine. You see them addicted to TV shows that have a lot of drama. You see a lot of very, very dysfunctional things in a woman who doesn't have enough time to herself to go within. And so healing begins within, and harmony comes into your life when you give yourself that time. And it does take effort. It's an effort. You have to ask for what you want. Then you have to carve that time out. You have to make it happen. You make it happen all day long, mom, wife, for your husband, for your kids. So make it happen for yourself.
Right.
And you will find that healing will come from within.
Wonderful. Jen Giordano, this has been wonderful. Oh, I do want to ask about some upcoming projects. What do you have going on?
Aylen, I am just really right now at this stage in my career, open and available on all levels. So when people follow me on Facebook, I tell them Mondays and Thursdays is when I do the womb song journeys, and I do them in the evening, Mountain Standard Time. I literally have like a women's circle from 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. Mountain Standard Time every Monday and every Thursday. And that time is specifically set aside for doing the womb song journey work with women. And you can pop in, pop out. It's usually about 33 minutes to get the full experience. You need at least 33 minutes of your time. Cool. And then you sit with it, you take that, and you go do it yourself. So you can always join me for womb song Zoom meditation calls. It's also called journey work because there is an energy healing component to it. Mm-hmm. Then I also offer private sessions where I go through a shamanic experience that's very, includes meditation and what we call life coaching, but I call it soul coaching because I'm speaking to you from your soul. I have the ability to access higher consciousness. So I have the ability to like tap into the Wi-Fi and channel messages to you. Now, I don't call it psychic, but that's what it is. Yeah. It's psychic channeling, So I'm offering those sessions. I range in my prices. I always work with your income level. Always. So I have the prices at $85 for an hour for the basic experience with me, all the way up to $265 for white tantra, which is 2 hours of like soul cleansing, deep reconnection work, which you would call soul retrieval. That's the term that a lot of people use for this work. I have my own style, my own methodologies that I use. I also teach Kundalini yoga. I don't teach Reiki. I haven't been doing Reiki per se, but I do teach Kundalini Kriya yoga as taught by Yogi Bhajan. And then I have Arialini, which is literally my favorite thing to do. And that's a combination of aerial yoga, Kundalini yoga, and sound healing at the end. I've done three workshops.
Very cool. And that's your own creation, right?
That is my, yeah, that is my baby. It's in fetal development right now. You know, I would like to make it a mystic fitness fad. I'd love to make it a fad, like booty yoga, you know?
Right.
Like that booty yoga thing. I would like to make it a fad and something kids can do with their moms, but it has spiritual benefits, energy benefits, as well as physical fitness benefits. Hormone, central nervous system, pituitary gland, pineal gland. I mean, we're working with so much when we do Arialini. We do mantra work, we do breath work, some floor work, some in the hammock. So I have quite a wide variety of offerings.
You do. Yes, you've got so many different things. I love it. But well, for people that do want to reach out to you, then where's the best place to find you? I'll have your information to write out, but if you want to go ahead and verbally tell us.
Thank you. So find me at Facebook under Jennifer Giordano. Giordano is the last name. That's a good way to find me. I do not go on Instagram. I'm not using Instagram. I'm not using Twitter. I have my own reasons for that. So Facebook, my website, that's the best place to go. Just JenGiordano.com. So JenGiordano.com. And go ahead and sign up for my email list, because my email list is where I really do most of the communicating about things like my book. When I get that completed and I'm ready to publish it, some people will get it for free. Some people will have to pay for it. If you're working with me, I'm probably going to offer the book for free, and it will be a story of transformation and rebirthing and all the different modalities that I've used to go through the past 10 years of my own personal journey. And you will learn about those modalities in this book. That's how you can reach out to me. I'm happy when you DM me through Facebook to like move you into the Find the Guru in You group.
Okay.
Or to, if you're a man and a woman and you're interested in that 40-day thing, or to move you into the womb song group if you're more interested in the womb healing. So those are the two directions, as well as Arialini, which is going to come later. This is the time for all of us to like earn our income and our living on doing what we love. Mm-hmm. And when you do what you love, the money will follow. That's something I learned from my first circus performer teacher with American Acrobats, Karen. That's something I learned from her.
Wonderful. Well, that I was going to ask if you had like something that you've learned that you want to kind of leave us with, but that sounds good too, unless there's something else you can think of.
Yeah, you know what? I want to say this. You cannot uncreate suffering until you sacrifice everything at the altar of unconditional love. And to reach true unconditional love, not the kind your ego says, oh yeah, you're being so loving because you're doing stuff. No, true unconditional love, where you can see somebody screaming in your face and not be affected by it. because you see their pain, right? You cannot uncreate your own suffering until you sacrifice all of everything at that altar of unconditional love. And if you want to get there, if you want to break through these kind of repeating patterns you might be experiencing with different people or different jobs, come to me, because I'm known for being a surgeon when it comes to getting to the root of what you're creating in your life, unplugging it, looking at it, loving it, and releasing it.
Absolutely. Yes. No, I had the pleasure, actually, everyone, of working with Jen recently, and we uncovered some stuff with me and my own mother. It was like really beautiful. Yeah. So she's doing Jen Giordano, everyone. Jen, thank you so, so much. We appreciate it. It's been amazing.
Thank you for inviting me to this beautiful experience with you. I'm very grateful and very honored, because Aylen is just one of the most compassionate and joyful and peaceful. She has a pure essence of kindness. Like, she embodies kindness. And I think we need more of that. Can we clone you?
Maybe we can. I'll just start by continuing to share what I know, just like you are. So thank you so much. Many blessings.
Blessings. Good night.